everybody. How are you doing today? My name is Dan. I'm the Jazz Shepherd, as most of you know. Those who haven't already, you should check out my Facebook jazz group called JVC, the Jazz Violin Club. Some great posts in there, great community. You see cool records posted every day, post chores. great way to keep abreast of what's happening. Some very knowledgeable people. Today we're going to do 12 Savoy records that I love. And it's a little bit different here with Savoy. The label was run by Herman Lubinsky. And I'll put a little picture of the guy right there if I can. He's a piece of work. He treats his musicians poorly. He's renowned for being incredibly cheap. He's also well known for not treating his black artists with any respect or dignity. Yet he also has the legacy of having recorded Charlie Parker after the war for the first time. He was part of some of Miles and Dizzy's early works. He's a San Getz. He's an important cat. He's limiting the modernity of the label in the LP era. He's very still rooted in the 40s. And I have an episode on Savoy, actually two of them, part one and two. You can go and learn more about the history of the label there and the discography. And just look at how many titles there you're not going to recognize. But a lot of the early LP era in 55 from Savoy is going to be documenting earlier, late 40s, early 50s recordings. Let's just dive in. We'll talk about it. First of all, I want to show you this Kenny Clarke 10-inch. It's not one of my Dirty Dozen. He plays on a lot of the records I'm going to show you. He innovates on drums in a great way, how he rides the ride cymbal. A guy you should really know about is Kenny Clarke. And we're going to start off with... So, Savoy runs with the 12,000 series. And of course, this is the great Charlie Parker. This is the first album on that series, number 12,000. Parker, if you don't know, is one of the four greats in jazz, in my estimation, the Mount Rushmore jazz, which is, of course, Armstrong, Ellington, Parker, and Monk. They're all four responsible for a lot of innovation. All four of them leave the landscape altered by their careers. This is, of course, recordings from much earlier, and it's still important because listen. I think that's Dizzy. Of course, him and Parker really changed jazz with bebop, and we don't have to dig into what bebop is right now, but it's a changing of the landscape. And like trap music changed hip-hop sound, bebop changed the sound of jazz. And if you were a young cat in jazz, you weren't trying to play swing anymore, you didn't care about Dixie, you wanted to try to play like that Parker guy. And a lot of tried, but none really emulate the pure playing of Parker. Because it's not trying to imitate. It's not even trying to innovate. It's just coming from a place of sincerity that saw through the chords and saw I could play these notes and be part of the scale and still get to my resolve at the end. And it's a huge innovation. So what we're going to find about Savoy here is a lot of it's important for historical context, which is also okay. By the way, that's Satchel Paige, the Negro League legend. This is when he played with the St. Louis Browns, who became the Baltimore Orioles. Also very much in that same tradition, the great Coleman Hawkins. And he's a generation before Parker even. He goes back to the Fletcher Henderson Orchestra in the late 20s, early 30s. He's the guy that really innovates tenor saxophone in general. It was kind of a marching instrument that blurted and didn't really have place as a lead instrument in any of compositions, including classical and symphony, all that stuff. Sax was not really an important instrument. And I think that's why we think of it with jazz so much. You see a sax, you think jazz, because jazz makes the sax a preeminent instrument, because it matches and reveals the male voice. You know, if you play tenor, it sounds like a male voice emulating. You gotta love Coleman Hawkins. He's a rich, beautiful player, always stuck in the melodic sense. He was always greater than the era he was a part of. And in the 50s, he makes some great small group sessions with labels like Riverside, Prestige. You gotta check out anything Coleman Hawkins does in the 50s, because he takes that maturity and sincerity of a grown man and puts it into some of the new sounds and new group combinations, and it's really just a wonderful thing. This is a rare record, and it's going to be a rare case in 1955 of Savoy being kind of current. They, like I said, that wasn't really their priority. It was to be part of what the new black movement was doing. Lubinsky was kind of an ass, and so the young black N-words, as it were, weren't going to tell him what the sound was anymore, you know. And you got to remember the colors and times of the 50s. In a place like Newark, New Jersey, race was a source of conflict every day. And you can be Italian and still be a half citizen. And so being black was tough, and being a Jew was tough. And Lubinsky was a tough 300-pound man, and he held an iron fist. He's been described as an arrogant bully. A couple clips I'm just going to read here. Went to such a loudmouth, overweight, cigar-smoking record man with little apparent charm. He a cheapskate. His oldest daughter said he was a paranoid about money. It consumed him like a burning fire. He had a reputation as an ogre in the business. You have no idea of the cheapness. That's your own daughter. And now, if you're looking at black youth as pretty much disposable, it can only imagine how it makes those black artists feel on your label, why a lot of them couldn't wait to get out of there and go to Blue Note or Riverside, which a lot did. But it's not to diminish what happens at Savoy, because a lot of great important things happen there. This record, of course, Cafe of Bohemia, featuring Nat Adderley, Horace Silver, Cannonball Adderley, Donald Byrd, Paul Chambers, and Jerome Richardson. That's heavy hitting. That's as great as what's happening at Blue Note in 1955-56. So this is a rare Savoy that's on the cusp of where jazz is. And like I said, Lubinsky wasn't in any kind of obligation on his part to stay with what was going on. A guy that I love dearly, and his career was cut short by Lubinsky, this is the great Little Jimmy Scott. Little Jimmy Scott is one of the great singers of this era. David Lynch brought him back for Twin Peaks Fire Walk With Me, singing by the sycamore tree. But, small fella. He sings like, I think it's like a contra alto or something like that it's called. He can really hit some high register. Okay. I like it. Yeah, that's right. Again, we're talking sex. That's just how this is. We can pretend it's anything else, but it's not. You know, that's the human condition in so many ways. But he makes a number of records at Savoy. And you gotta be careful because there are a lot of them have been reissued with different covers later on in the 12,000 sequence into the like 12,100s and 12,400s. You'll start seeing the same records with different covers. He eventually kind of falls out of favor with Lubinsky. He records a record with Ray Charles on the Tangerine label. And Lubinsky is irate. And he blocks the release of that record. And it gets withdrawn. And that act of just vile anger and control drives Jimmy out of the recording business for years, decades. And if I recall, it's actually David Lynch who kind of brings him back to record for that film soundtrack. But you can hear. He does mostly, you know, songbook stuff, American Songbook. But his interpretations are very soft and thoughtful. You know, it's not lacking integrity. It seems genuine. For what I believe is number four on my list here, we're going to look at a guy by the name of Young Donald Byrd. And this is a tough record to find. And you'll see here, that's the Young Donald Byrd of Blue Note fame, playing with Kenny Clarke, Frank Foster, Hank Jones, and Dave Chambers on the bass. But what's important about this, again, this is Savoy being current. And these are pretty much unknown commodities at this point. Like, not like Donald Byrd was his name that Lubinsky had to sign. It was some kid from the area who he threw a couple bucks at and said, get in there and record, black kid. You know? But this is one of Byrd's first recordings. Let's see, he does some pretty early stuff. Transition, which is great. A little small New England label. But then, of course, New England, he goes to Blue Note, and that's the rest of the story for him, where he's one of the legends of the Blue Note label. But great Donald Byrd, and great Savoy being in the modern sound and hard bopping. And this record is one of those Savoys that's hard to find for under 100, 200 bucks. And it can climb up into the 600-800 range for a nice copy. Beat up copies will sell for 50, 60 bucks. But the great thing about old LPs is they might look pretty beat up on the surface, but the groove is in there deep and they will play through a lot. And the softer the music, the more you might be annoyed by some of the surface small cackles, the fire crackle. But if it's got a lot of horns in it and it's really hard driven, this one's actually a pretty good sounding copy. But it's certainly one of those LPs that they'll sell a beat up copy for 60 bucks. And so that kind of stuff bothers you. You should keep your eyes open. A guy I love a lot, and I've been learning to like his later recordings even. Hank Jones. And Hank Jones is the brother of Thad Jones and Elvin Jones, so it's a great jazz family. He's the guy that plays piano on Autumn Leaves on the Cannonball Adderley Something Else record with Miles Davis. He has a number of five records, I believe, as a leader on Savoy. And this is one of my favorites, a little trio session. That's Kenny Clarke on the drums, and is it Wendell Marshall on the bass? Absolutely. And beautiful cover. And part of why I love Savoy is a lot of it's real loud black and white, but by 57 they start doing these kind of tricolor tones. And I'm 47, so I'm old enough that when I was a kid and go to my grandparents' basements, they would have old magazines and old LPs and stuff with this aesthetic, this kind of color setup. And so it's just kind of nostalgic for me. And Savoy, I think, being one of the poorest art departments, again, probably Lubinsky's doing, why pay someone to put art on a cover? Let's just slap some shit on there. But because their art department was so not forward thinking and just kind of, this is do what else everyone else is doing around there and make it look like a box of Cheerios, who cares? A lot of them are just black and white photos from 12,000 all the way to about 12,060. Most of those records are very much just a single color, usually black and white or tan and white. And they start adding color in places like 12053, sorry. And the covers start getting some color at this point. But great record, worth finding. You see this in a thrift store, grab it. Savoys are on the cusp of being pretty expensive. Certain titles can be very expensive. But for the most part, there's so many obscure titles on Savoy. You know, I'm showing you now kind of the name guys. And notice a lot of them are the black guys. And these are the ones that are collectible and valuable. There's a ton of Italians, a lot of just kind of obscure white names that you don't really ever hear about or see them or talk about them. And you don't know them until you stumble on them. You're like, oh shit, who's this? What's this? I'll give you just a couple quick examples. Borderline, Ray McKinley. You ever heard of that guy? The New Orleans Nightingale. Laverne Smith, which is actually an outstanding record. Never heard of her until I found it. Lloyd Meets Stravinsky, piano. The jazz keyboards of Marion McPartland, Lenny Tristano. Like, again, that's classic art department there. A pair of pianos, Eddie Costa, John Meehan. The amazing Johnny Costa, another piano player. Herbie Brock, another piano player you've never heard of. You know, even this Ronnie Scott record. It's actually a fantastic record, great hard driving session. But there's a lot of very obscure titles on Savoy that you've never seen or heard of or have a ton of collector value, a large part because this is black music. And why would you go listen to a bunch of white rappers from the 80s when you can listen to the black rappers who innovated and designed this music and have something genuine to say? You know, Chuck D's got some power to his voice. Vanilla Ice, a little bit fluffy. And I'm going to take some of that back. White jazz players are better than Vanilla Ice. Those are great records. They're great players. But they lack the context of that history to give them that extra charge, that extra source of power. Because when you win the crosshairs of history, there's a lot of energy flowing. If you'll think about that. You win the crosshairs of history. 1950s post-war America, the new empire has come on the scene. You still haven't been given the freedom you were promised when you fought in the war. There's tension and poverty in the American ghettos. We have descended into the post-apocalyptic kind of elites and the super have-nots. And this music is in that crosshair. This is a great record. Tough one to find. The Composer's Workshop. It's got Charlie Mingus, Walt Cirillo, Teo Macero, and Johnny Laporta. It's a hard record to come by, man. And, yeah, it's two different sessions. But this is a fun album cover. Just takes me back to my grandpa's basement again, which no record does that like Savoy. You know, the other record labels, jazz art departments were ahead of the curve. They were ahead of what was happening in most advertising, most marketing. Savoy? I'll put that on a bologna package, man. I don't give no shit. Herman Lubinsky, man. The guy that I'm gonna give some love to, deserves it, he doesn't get enough. There's a guy by the name of Joe Wilder. I'm a huge fan of Joe Wilder. Now we're at 12063, and so we're probably talking 58. One of my favorite Savoy covers, and one of their best. Like a Charlie Shavers. kind of slips through the cracks. He ends up on Columbia and makes some pretty decent recordings there. But he does side work for everybody. A lot of the great singers. Joe Wilder's name will show up. I keep finding his name. I'm like, oh. He doesn't have a ton of stuff as a leader. This one on Savoy. I can think of two on Columbia. There's a couple other ones out there. But this is a great Savoy record. And it's very modern. Melodic driven. A record I just want to give a quick shout out to. Because I've already covered this record in my Jazz Messenger series and my Hank Mobley series. These are two Hank Mobley records that come out 1264, 12092, and along with the Donald Byrd, and there's a Lee Morgan record. These are some of the most collectible Savoys. I've already talked about them. Check out the Hank Mobley episode where I go in depth in all of Mobley's discography. One of the great tenor players that gets forgotten about. Just had to give a mention to those, though I couldn't do an episode on Savoy and not show them. One of the better album covers that Savoy has in the 50s is this fabulous Bill Jackson record. Bill Jackson, of course, was a member of the Modern Jazz Quartet, and he does a lot of records as a solo artist as well. And he also shows up on a lot of side work. There's with Lucky Thompson, Hank Jones, Wendell Marshall, and Kenny Clarke. And so you're talking about a session now at this stage. This is cooking. This is as good as anything Milk did on Blue Note or anything good Milk did on Prestige. Great lineup. Five black men in an uncomfortable environment, still setting down their weapons and saying, you know what, let's just put some love in the room. Let's turn up the heat a little bit. Don't be uncomfortable, Mr. Lubinsky. Go sign them checks. See what I'm saying? Go sign them checks. Because we're not who you think we are. We are brilliant. We are to be loved. And it must be hard to work for someone that had kind of a disregard for you and your people. The Lee Morgan record, again, not one of my dozen, worth finding, and I'll talk about this record a lot more in episodes to come, but that's a Savoy worth finding. This is a tough Savoy to find, and this is probably my favorite Savoy album cover. I had to go to Japan for this one. There's no getting around it. I don't got the type of economics to be buying too many $200 records. But this is the Detroit Jazzmen, and just a great picture of Detroit in the background, which was, in this era, probably the third greatest city in America. In terms of industrial power and commercial wealth and size of industrial center, it was a huge manufacturing center, big population, a big urban downtown with lots of skyscrapers. The New York skyline in the 50s is the greatest in the world. There's no one, they're the top five spots. Chicago's in the next slot because they had a great skyline from the 20s, 30s, 40s, although not much was built in the 40s, of course. But then Detroit's number three. Detroit has a fabulous skyline of great art deco, beaux arts, beautiful old classical architecture. But that aside, these are all Detroit guys that were big on Blue Note, Prestige, Riverside. There's a Savoy session. We got Pepper Adams, Tommy Flanagan, Paul Chambers, Kenny Burrell. All of them are guys that I love dearly. Again, there's no reason why you could not hear this record on Blue Note. But this also goes for, like I said, a couple hundred bucks generally. I guess the Japanese pressings go for 30. So now we're in the 1960-61, 12,117. And this is one of the first times that Savoy is going to approach dissonance. It wasn't something Lubinsky had a whole lot of time for. Again, he shied away from what was current all the time. They're still reissuing Parker stuff. You know, we're 117 releases in. And this is as ethnic, as challenging, and as unique a piece you'll find on Savoy up to this point. Again, we're 117 releases in, and there's probably 24 records in there that are firm established records in the jazz canon, and then the rest of it to varying degrees is kind of unknown. I mean, I'll probably do an episode at some point where I show you how many Savoys you've never seen. It's cool to have it for this historical context. And again, the more pieces you have of a label, the more you can talk about that label's overall impact and what was driving, what was governing it. And to have complete discographies of all these labels has taught me so much, you know. Great album cover. Just wonderful. And the band is also modern with Yusuf Lateef, Wilbur Harden, Hugh Lawson, Ernie Farrow, and Oliver Jackson. Yusuf's a pretty prolific recorder. Another Detroit guy. He has probably 6 records on Savoy, and some of the toughest, most expensive records to find on Savoy. And then he migrates to Prestige and does some stuff there on New Jazz, ends up on Impulse, where he makes a long discography there as well. And the thing about those 6 records he does at Savoy, and they pretty much all come out in 1958-59. So it's, again, it's the scale and the work that these guys put in, it's not comparable to what rock and roll or R&B guys do. These guys kind of have these conversations with their horns for a living. And it's almost a daily experience. And unlike a rock song that you can get sick of playing, I can play my song different every day depending on how I feel. So you can track the same record 6 months later with the same tracks even, and have it be pretty prolific difference between those records. Listen to Coltrane, various versions of My Favorite Things. You know what I'm saying? What he does on the Impulse, My Favorite, ain't the same as what he does on the Atlantic, My Favorite Things. So wrapping up here now on Savoy, another guy who makes a nice string of records with a great group is great trombone player Curtis Fuller. Fuller is also a Blue Note guy. Makes a number of great records there. He's on Blue Train. He's one of the go-to trombone players in the hard bop era. A lot of his records would be pretty expensive. This was a great group he put together at Savoy. They make probably 3 or 4 records here in 1959-60, maybe even 61. Curtis Fuller, Benny Golson, Lee Morgan, Wynton Kelly, Paul Chambers, and Charlie Person. So that's as solid a lineup as you'll ever find on Savoy. And by this stretch of the Savoy discography, 12-1-4-3, yeah, other guys in there like Kenny Barron and Shahib Sihab, there's other cats coming into the discography here that are a little bit more pushing the envelope. But Savoy's about to leave jazz. They're about to go fairly strongly into the gospel thing. And when they do, they pretty much leave jazz in its wake. And I think Lubinsky probably saw jazz wasn't a viable financial thing anymore. You know, some would get some church ladies to sing on these records and get rid of those young black kids. Don't really need them anyway. So, as much as Lubinsky's kind of a heel, Savoy's still a very important part of the chapter and part of the jazz canon. And his work with Gillespie and Parker and those guys alone makes him a seminal figure in jazz. So you gotta love Savoy, you gotta dig out your Savoy records, and by all means, the 12 I showed you are great things to have. Appreciate you. I'm the Jazz Shepherd. Subscribe to the channel, check out my Facebook group. I appreciate you all. Be safe. Peace.